الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Today's topic, inshallah ta'ala, that I'm going to speak about is the virtues and the importance in knowing the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His characteristics. How important is it that we know Allah's names? And what are the virtue in knowing the names of Allah and His characteristics? What virtue come with it? Because some of you may think to yourselves, what would it benefit me if I knew Allah's names? How would that affect my day-to-day life? What benefit would it bring forward to me? I hope, inshallah ta'ala, after this lecture, it will answer your question. And you will know the importance of knowing Allah's names and how it will affect your life once you do know His names. And you know its meaning and what it entails. My plan, inshallah ta'ala, is to mention 16 points. There are more than that that can be mentioned, but I will mention 16 points with their evidences in how important it is to know Allah's names and the virtues that are in it, and how it can affect your day-to-day life, how it can affect your perception in this world, and the way that you live your life. The first one, Asma'ullah al-Husna, Allah's great and noble names, min a'zami asbabi dukhul al-Jannah. One of the greatest ways to enter Jannah is knowing Allah's names, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isn't it not? What brought you here today? What made you want to listen to this lecture? To enter Jannah, isn't that what you want? Knowing Allah's names, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and living by it is one of the ways to enter Jannah. Rather, it's from one of the greatest ways to enter it. مِنْ أَعْظَمِ أَسْبَابِ دُخُولِ الْجَنَّةِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لِلَّهِ تِسْعَةٌ وَتِسْعُونَ اسْمًا. Allah has 99 names. The Prophet said this. مِئَةٌ إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ لَا يَحْفَظُهَا أَحَدٌ إِلَّا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. No one memorizes those 99 names except he what? Except that he enters Jannah. No one memorizes it. Another riwayah says, مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Anyone who narrows down these names, has all of these names, he will enter Jannah. But some people, they think memorizing these names means you know it off the top of your head only. And that is not the case. It doesn't just mean that. It also means that you live by what these names mean. For example, from the names of Allah is Allah. Ismullah al-A'zam. This name Allah, what does it mean? Ma'luh, a ma'bud. The one that should be worshipped alone. That's what it means. So if you're saying, I've memorized the 99 names of Allah, and then you're worshipping other than Allah, have you really memorized the name of Allah? Do you fall under the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ here? Whoever memorizes it, he will enter Jannah. Man ahsaha dakhala al-Jannah. No, you won't. Because the hifz means memorizing it from the top of your head and also living by it and coming with what it means. So the first point that we take from knowing Allah's names is that anyone who memorizes it and lives by it will enter Jannah. Number two, the names of Allah, Asma'ullah al-Husna tu'arrifuka billahi ta'ala. The names of Allah will allow you to know who Allah is. If you want to know Allah through His names, you can know Him. By studying his names, you know him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ The companion, Abi Ka'b رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, أَنَّ الْمُشْرِكِينَ قَالُوا لِلنَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The pagans, they said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, يَا مُحَمَّدْ إِنْسِبْ لَنَا رَبَّكْ Give us your Lord's lineage. Where does he go back to? What's his off? Where's his father? Where, tell us where he's from. And then what came down was, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ In that is اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ إذن أحد is in there, الصَّمَدُ is in there. This surah, which has Allah's names in it, it defined for us and allowed us to know who Allah is. Allah is As-Samad. Allahu Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is Ahad. Surah Al-Ikhlas. Number three, knowing the names of Allah, the virtue that comes from it, the benefits that come from it. The third one is Asma'ullahi al-Husna aslu kullu ibadah. The foundation of every ibadah is connected to the names of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The foundation of every single ibadah is connected to what? Knowing the names of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The great scholar, the great Imam, Abu al-Qasim al-Taymiyyu al-Asbahani, Qam al-Sunnah, when he spoke about the importance of knowing Allah's names, he said, قال بعض العلماء, some scholars said, he said, أول فرض فرضه الله على خلقه معرفته. The greatest thing Allah made obligatory on His slaves is to know Him. The greatest obligation Allah placed on us is to know Him. فَإِذَا عَرَفَهُ النَّاسُ عَبَدُهُ Look at this benefit. If the people, they know Allah, they worship Him. And then look, he brought the evidence for it. He said, وَقَالَ تَعَالَى Allah said, فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Know Muhammad and know everyone that there is none worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jalla. فَيَنْبَغِي لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ It is obligatory on every single Muslim أَنْ يَعْرِفُوا أَسْمَاءَ اللَّهِ That they know the names of Allah. وَتَفْسِيرَهَا And its meanings. فَيُعَظِّمُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ عَظَمَتِهِ So they can glorify, they can venerate Allah the way He deserves to be glorified and venerated. ولذلك anyone who knows, for example, Allah is Hayyun Kareem, Allah is shy. From the characteristics of Allah is that He's shy. And Allah is generous. If the person comes to know that, does it not affect his ibadah in a positive way? It does. What does it do? قَوِيَ رَجَاءُهُ His hope in Allah increases. So knowing Allah's name, Al-Hayy, Al-Kareem, knowing this, that He's shy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that He's Kareem, that He's generous, comes with an ibadah which is vital, which is what? Al-Raja, hope. The person will then have hope in Allah Azza wa Jalla. And his desire in Allah Azza wa Jalla increases. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى Your Lord, حَيِّيٌ كَرِيمٌ Allah is shy. Allah Azza wa Jalla is generous. يَسْتَحِي مِنْ عَبْدِي Allah is shy from his slave. In what? إِذَا رَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ If he raises his hands, أَنْ يَرُدَّهُمَا صِفْرًا That Allah turns your hands away without giving you what you're asking for. Allah is shy to do that. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when the person comes to know that this is the characteristics and the attribute of Allah, what does it increase? It increases your hope in Allah. And it increases your desire in wanting to turn to Him first. So this point, which is Asma'ullah al-Husna, knowing Allah's names, what does it do? Aslu kulli ibadah. It's the foundation of every ibadah. You're not able to come with ibadatul raja unless you have what? Knowledge of Allah's names. Number four, Asma'ullahi al-Husna a'zamu al-asbab li-ijabati al-du'a. One of the greatest way in a person's dua being accepted, one of the greatest way for a person's dua to be accepted is what? One of the greatest way for a person's dua to be accepted is what? It is knowing Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala's name, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Look what Allah said in the Quran. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah has what? Allah has noble names, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. For Allah, there are majestic, there are noble names. فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Call unto Allah with those names. Here the scholars, they take from it that when the person is asking Allah for good, then he should use those names of Allah that indicate that meaning. Are we all together? He should not say, Allahumma ghfirni ya shadeed al-iqab. Oh Allah, forgive me, the one who is severe in his punishment. No. The person should say, ya arhamar rahimeen, the most merciful one, forgive me. Meaning, fad'uuhu biha, call on to Allah with his names, that which is befitting for the context and what you're asking for. وَلِذَلِكَ, when the person does that, the chances of their dua being accepted is very high. Look what the Prophet ﷺ used to say, alayhi salatu wasalam. He used to do tawassul through what? Allah's names. He used to say, أَسْأَلُكَ, I ask you, O Allah. Through what? بِكُلِّ اسْمٍ هُوَ لَكَ, all of the names which you own. سَمَّيْتَ بِهِ نَفْسَكَ, which you've named yourself. I'm asking you, O Allah. Through what? Through your names. Which names? The one you gave yourself, O Allah. أَوْ أَنْزَلْتَوْ فِي كِتَابِكَ, or the names that you have sent down in your book. You've mentioned it in the Quran. أَوْ عَلَّمْتَوْ أَحَدَ مِنْ خَلْقِكَ, or the names which you have taught a creation from your creations. أَوْ أَنْزَلْتَوْ فِي كِتَابِكَ, أَوْ إِسْتَأْثَرْتَ بِي فِي عِلْمِ الْغَيْبِ عِنْدَكَ, or a name that you have chosen not to tell anyone and you are the only one who knows, I also ask you on that name as well. So what we take from this is, Allah's names are what? They are more than 99. That there are more. Because the Prophet said, أَوْ إِسْتَأْثَرْتَ بِهِ فِي عِلْمِ الْغَيْبِ عِنْدَكَ. Those names you have chosen to keep and you've kept it in the unknown knowledge. Ilmul Ghaib, no one knows it. I also ask you those names. So look at the messenger. And then he goes, he asks, أَنْ تَجْعَلَ الْقُرْآنَ رَبِيعَ قَلْبِي وَنُورَ صَدْرِي, until he carried on his dua. But look at that. Before he made the dua, which is, oh Allah, made the Qur'an the spring of my heart, what did he start with? أَسْأَلُكَ بِكُلِّ اسْمٍ هُوَ لَكَ سَمَّيْتَ بِهِ نَفْسَكَ أَوْ أَنْزَلْتَهُ فِي كِتَابِكَ أَوْ عَلَّمْتَهُ أَحَدًا مِنْ خَلْقِكَ أَوْ إِسْتَأْثَرْتَ بِهِ فِي عِلْمِ الْغَيْبِ عِنْدَكَ. All of that. Then he asked Allah based on what? Whatever he wanted. The reason why he did that, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is first of all, he was following the ayah, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْبَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Number two is what? Through the names of Allah, the dua, the chances of it being accepted is very high. It is what? It is high. Number five. Allah loves, subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَسْمَاءَهُ الْحُسْنَى. Anyone who loves Allah's names, who's always willing to learn it, who is studying it, he's giving it time. Allah loves the one who loves his names. If you are always wanting to know the name of Allah, you're studying it, you're giving it importance, Allah loves you. There is a story, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, ba'atha rajulan, ba'atha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent a man, sariyah, he sent a man, وَكَانَ يَقْرَأُ لِأَصْحَابِهِ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ. The man would lead the prayer, he would read a surah, فَيَخْتِمُ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ, and whenever he would finish whatever surah he wanted to read, before he went to the ruku', he would read قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. Every day, every time, every prayer, he will do this. فَلَمَّا رَجَعُوا, when the people came back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they told him what happened, or what this man did, or what he does. He reads a surah, and what does he do? He reads Surah Al-Ikhlas after it. The Prophet ﷺ said, سَلُوهُ لِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ يَصْنَعُ ذَلِكَ. Ask this man, what is it that's making him do this? Why is he choosing to do this? And so they went and they asked him. And then he said, لِأَنَّهَا صِفَةُ الرَّحْمَانِ. These are the characteristics of Ar-Rahman, Allah. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ أَنَا الصَّمَدْ أَنَا الْأَحَدْ. These are the characteristics of my Lord. وَأَنَا أُحِبُّ. And I love أَنْ أَقْرَأَ بِهَا. To read these characteristics, I love it. So he loves the names, he loves the characteristics, this noble companion. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The messenger then said, أَخْبِرُوهُ. Tell him, أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّهُ. Allah loves him. Tell this man, Allah loves him. In another wording and another riwayah, the man said, إِنِّي أُحِبُّهَا. Why do you read this surah after every recitation? After every surah that you read, why do you finish it with قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ? He said, because I love it. The messenger then said, حُبُّكَ إِيَّاهَا. The love that you hold for this surah, أَدْخَلَكَ الْجَنَّةِ, has entered you into Jannah. The love that you have for this surah, Surah Al-Ikhlas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to place you into Jannah. So knowing Allah's names and attributes, this is the virtue and the blessings and the greatness that it holds. Number six, asking Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala specifically to uplift from you distress and hardship. I mean, I did mention dua in general, but I felt it was important that we also mention the pain and the agony a person may endure in their life. The humum and the kurub, the hardship and the stress that you may go through in your life. If you use Allah's names, it's one of the greatest chances or the greatest means for it to be uplifted from you. Du'a'ullahi bi asma'ihi al-husna a'azamu asbabi tafriju al-kurubi wa zawali al-humumi. Look what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. مَا أَصَابَ أَحَدًا قَطٌّ هَمٌّ وَلَا حَزَنٌ. No one goes through hardship, as in stress, and they go through anxieties, and etc. فَقَالَ. Then the person says, اللهم أو الله إني عبدك. I am your slave. ابن عبدك. The son of your slave. ابن أمتك. The son of your female slave. ناصيتي بيدك. My affairs is in your hands. ناصيه means the front of the hair. Meaning you're controlling my affairs. All of my affairs is in your hand. ناصيتي بيدك. ماض في حكمك. Your judgments, they fully apply on me. I can't repel it. Whether it be the أحكام القدرية or the أحكام الشرعية, they all fall on me. The universal rulings or the legislative rulings, they all apply on me, oh Allah. عَدْلٌ فِيَّ قَضَاءُكْ. You are fair in your judgments, oh Allah. أَسْأَلُكَ, oh Allah, I ask you, بِكُلِّ اسْمٍ هُوَ لَكْ سَمَّيْتَ بِهِ نَفْسَكَ أَوْ عَلَّمْتَ أَحَدًا مِّنْ خَلْقِكَ أَوْ أَنْزَلْتَهُ فِي كِتَابِكَ أَوْ إِسْتَأْثَرْتَ بِهِ فِي عِلْمِ الْغَيْبِ عِنْدَكَ أَنْ تَجْعَلَ الْقُرْآنَ رَبِيعَ قَلْبِي وَنُورَ صَدْرِي وَجَلَاءَ حُزْنِي وَذَهَابَ هَمِّي. The Prophet asked for two things here, a lot, but he asked mainly two things that I want to focus on. Oh Allah, remove stress, sadness from my heart. After, what did he say? أَسْأَلُكَ بِكُلِّ اسْمٍ هُوَ لَكَ. In another hadith, Ibn Abbas narrated, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, whenever he would be going through a karb, a hardship, he would say, La ilaha illallahu al-Aliyyu al-Azim. This is what the Prophet would say. Ama la ilaha illallahu al-Azim al-Ali. Ama halim. Different wordings. La ilaha, that there is none worthy of worship. Rabbu al-samawati wal-ardi wa rabbu al-ashi al-Azim. All of these are what? These are names of Allah. Whenever the messenger would go through hardship, he would make this dua. He would say, La ilaha illa Allahu al-Azim al-Halim. La ilaha illa Allahu Rabbu al-Samawati wal-Ardi wa Rabbu al-Arsh al-Azim. So he would use at the times of hardship the names of Allah. Number six, Asma'ullahi al-Husna. Allah's names, once you know it, you have knowledge of all sciences. not in details, but you have the reality of what knowledge is. Knowing Allah's names gives you the opportunity and allows you to have the reality of what's out there. The reality that is out there. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who possesses the knowledge of everything, true or false. And the more you study the one that knows everything, Allah knows, brothers, what has happened in the past. Allah knows what's happening now. Allah knows what's going to happen in the future. Allah even knows that which hasn't happened. If it was to happen, the way it would happen. He knows it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It hasn't happened. It will not even happen. But he knows how, if it was to happen, how it would happen. بَلْ بَدَى لَهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُخْفُونَ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَلَوْ رُدُّوا لَعَادُوا لِمَا نُهُوا عَنْهُ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَكَاذِبُونَ. When the disbelievers, the day of judgment, they come and they say, oh Allah, give us a second chance. Let us go back to the world. We promise you, O Lord, that we will fix up and that we will follow your command. What does Allah say? وَلَوْ رُدُّوا لَعَادُوا لِمَا نُهُوا عَنْهُ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَكَاذِبُونَ. If they were being taken back to the world again and they were given a second chance, they are liars. They would carry on from where they left off. They would not change. Has that happened? Has that happened? Were they given a second chance? No. But does Allah know what's going to happen if they were given a second chance? This is from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is infinite. So knowing Him subhanahu wa ta'ala that much allows you to know a lot. Allows you to what? Know Allah. Because Allah is what? Allahumma anta al-awwal falaysa qablaka shay. Oh Allah, you're the first, there was no one before you. Nothing before you. Wa anta al-akhir, you are the last. فَلَيْسَ بَعْدَكَ شَيْءٌ, there's nothing after you. The one who's the beginning and the end knows everything. So learning Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala's names, you learn everything. You learn everything. The reality of things. Number 8. Knowing Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala's names is the real meaning of where khashya comes from. Khashya comes from really knowing Allah Azza wa Jal. To have khashya, to have humility, to have fear in your heart, it really comes from knowing who Allah is. It does. That is why ma'rifatu asma, ma'rifatu Allah bi asma'ihi wa sifatihi aslu khashyati tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, innama yakhsha Allah min ibadihi al-ulama. The people who truly fear Allah are who? The scholars. Why does Allah say that the people... Let's ponder on the verse. Let's actually explain what the verse means. What does the verse say? The verse says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. In the Arabic language, ulama should have come before the word Allah in the sequence of how the grammar and in the Arabic structure. English language, it's a what? It's a subject, verb, object context. صح? English subject comes first, and then the verb comes, and then the object comes. So it's an SVO language. Do you understand? Subject comes first, then the verb, and then the object. When you grammatically analyze a sentence. No, the Arabic language, the verb comes first, and then the subject, and then the object. If that sequence gets changed in the Arabic language, if the sequence gets changed, one goes before the other, there comes out from it a benefit, which is known as hasr, exclusivity. If that sequence changes, the subject goes before the verb. Are we all together, brothers? What happens? The meaning becomes exclusivity. And I'll explain that in more details now. Let's look at the verse now. Who is the one who is... What is the action that's taking place here? What's the verb that's happening here? What is it? Khashya. Khashya is the verb. The fear is the verb that's happening here. Okay, who's doing it? The ulama are doing it. So Arabic, what did we say? It's verb, which is khashya. Innama yakhsha Allah. Yakhsh came, okay. Who are the ones who are scared? The scholars. That's the subject. And who's been scared? Who do they fear? Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is how it should have been. Khashya, ulama, Allah. That was meant to be the order. But what happened here? Khashya came, and then what came? Allah, and then the ulama went after. The order changed. So the fa'il and the maf'ul, back and forth. I'm back to front. The scholars, they say this shows exclusivity. Exclusivity what? They call it hasr. Ithbatul hukmi lil madhkur wa lafu amma ada. Means no one else fears Allah except the scholars. That's the reason why that order changed. No one else has khashiyah except the ulama. No one else does. Everyone else is negated from them. And it's exclusive to who? Khashiyah is exclusive to who? Huh? Scholars. So the question is, who is the scholar? The scholar is the one who knows Allah's names, and he knows what it means, and he lives by it. Let's look at the kalam of the salaf, rahimahumullah. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he said, إِنَّمَا يَخَافُ اللَّهُ فَيَتَّقِي عِقَابَهُ بِطَاعَتِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ بِقُدْرَتِهِ عَلَى مَا يَشَاءُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وَأَنَّهُ يَفْعَلُ مَا يُرِيدُ. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he said, they fear Allah. They have piety of Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's punishments. Why is it? Because they know Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala, He does whatever He wishes. They know Him. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, what did he say? ليس العلم عن كثرة الرواية ولكن العلم الخشية. Knowledge is not the one who has more narrations, more books he's read, he has more quotes. That's not knowledge, that's information. There's a difference between information and knowledge. This person has information, he doesn't have knowledge. Knowledge is the one who has what? He knows Allah's names, he understands it, and he lives by it. From the names of Allah is Ar-Raqib. Ar-Raqib is the one who observes His creation. The one who knows this is the name of Allah, he knows privately and publicly what he does, Allah is observing it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will not be from those people, Allah says, يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعَهُمْ إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مَا لَا يَرْضَى مِنَ الْقَوْلِ. That when they are in the eyes of the people, in front of the people, they observe what they say, they observe what they do, they are worried. They won't do this in front of the people. But when they become private and they become alone and there's no one else with them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. They are conscious and they're fearing of the people. وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ. But they are not conscious and fearful of Allah. وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعَهُمْ. And Allah is with them. إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مَا لَا يَرْضَى مِنَ الْقَوْلِ. When they are saying and doing what they are doing. I'll give you an example. وَبِالْمِثَالِ يَتَضْحُ الْمَقَالِ. With examples, things become clear. You now live in the UAE. You know in the UAE there's laws, there's regulations when it comes to driving on the road. You know that if you drive more than a particular speed, that a ticket will come to you and etc. You know the pain of paying that fine. You know how painful it is. Somebody just came from either India, Somalia, whatever. And they landed in UAE. And they were given a car. And they were told, drive. They don't know about cameras. They don't know the consequences that you have to bear if you drive fast. Will their driving be the same as the driving of the one who knows the reality of the camera and the consequences that this camera can put them through, and what they have to do from after they go through this camera? Huh? No. And Allah, His example is greater. The one who knows Allah, who's aware of Allah, is the one who knows that Allah is observing him and Allah is looking at him. So his harakat, his movements, his silence, his private affairs, his public affairs, all of them are, he's very conscious of what he does. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ ونعلم ما توسوس به نفسه ونحن أقرب إليه من حبل الوريد إذ يتلقى المتلقيان عن اليمين وعن الشمال قعيد ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد. Everything he knows, he says. Every word he utters, he knows that from the names of Allah is that he is raqib, he is observing. He can see everything his slave is doing. So this, what does it do automatically to the person who has knowledge of Allah? It builds in his heart khashya. Just like the example I gave before, that this person is scared of that ticket. وَلِذَلِكَ look what the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّ أَتْقَاكُمْ وَأَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ أَنَا. The one, the Prophet said this عليه الصلاة والسلام, the one who has the most taqwa of Allah, and the one who knows Allah the most. Look how he connected taqwa and knowing Allah the most. He said, both of them is me. I know Allah more, and that has led to my piety being more than the rest of you. Are you with me, brothers? So this shows us that knowing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and having knowledge of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, it brings to the person al-khashya. The Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith, أَنَا عَلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ, I know Allah the most. And look what he said, وَأَشَدُّكُمْ لَهُ خَشْيَةً, and I have the most khashya. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِذَلِكَ, of course he does. His wife Aisha saw the Prophet ﷺ pray one night, and she saw his legs, حَتَّى تَتَفَرَّتْ قَدَمَاهُ, his legs swollen, blood filled his legs, salawatullah, ripped cracks were in his leg. And then she said to him, O Messenger of Allah, Allah has forgiven you for your past sins and your upcoming sins. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَرَ. Allah has forgiven you for your past sins. Allah has forgiven you for what's going to come. You're clean. So why don't you relax? Look at how he knows his Lord. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Am I not going to be a slave that shows gratitude to that Lord? He's forgiven me for everything, and should I not show him gratitude? Are you with me, brothers? So because he knows his Lord Allah Azza wa Jalla a lot. Number 9, من عرف الله من عرف أسماء الله. Anyone who knows Allah's names, كما ينبغي فقد عرف كل شيء. Anybody who knows Allah's names, he truly knows everything in the way it is. He knows everything the way it is. What do I mean by that? For example, if you know Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is ghani, rich, doesn't need anyone, what does that give you? Who is the one who's in need then? You. If Allah is the most knowledgeable one, then who's the ignorant one? You believe it's you. If Allah is the one that's going to remain and is never going to perish, then who is the one that's going to die and perish? Because you know you're the opposite of Allah. Allah says in the Quran, Ya أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله والله هو الغني الحميد. Oh people, you're the ones who are in need of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah is rich. He doesn't need anyone. Allah says in another ayah, كل من عليها فان, everything on this earth will perish. And then look, Allah tells you the opposite, which is Him. ويبقى وجه ربك ذي الجلال والإكرام. But Allah will remain. He will not perish subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tells us that He's the one who knows and we don't know. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows and you don't know. So by knowing Allah's names, it humbles you, which is one of the characteristics of servitude. Complete humility and humbleness comes to you. You really know who you are. Think about it today. If you ponder on how many mistakes that we do every day, how many shortcomings that we come with, and how He forgives us. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْ يُؤَاخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ, if Allah was to grab the people in everything which they have put forward, if He grabbed them the minute they did it, مَا تَرَكَ عَلَىٰ ظَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةِ, Allah would leave no one on the face of this earth. Everybody would be punished. You today, if somebody does you wrong, you want to retaliate there and then. I'm going to show this person, watch. Wallahi, watch. Allah. That's what you say, right? Like, look at Allah. People are saying Allah has what? وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا. Allah has a child. Allah says in the Quran, تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَا. The sky was about to fall down. وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضِ The earth was about to crack. وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ هَدَّى أَنْ دَعُوا لِلْرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدًا وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلْرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا The mountains were about to fall down. From that statement alone, the creation around us cannot tolerate that statement that Allah has a child. And then Allah says, وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلْرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا It's not befitting for Allah to take a child. مع ذلك, He let those creation live. He nurtures them. He provides for them. He gives them children. He gives them wealth. He gives them money. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. This makes you really understand how merciful He is. And that how we are insignificant. Look at the two great prophets of Allah. That day, those two prophets, there was no one more knowledgeable than them. That day, there was no one more knowledgeable than them. Who was it? Nabiullah Musa and Nabiullah Khadir. Khadir was a prophet. The strongest opinion is that Khadir was a what? Was a prophet from the prophets of Allah. Because he said in the Quran, وَمَا فَعَلْتُ عَنْ أَمْرِي ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا I did not do this from my own self. Hey, where did you do it from? His meaning is I got revelation for it. Him and Nabiullah Musa were together. Khadir and Musa are walking together. Ponder over this. And they are together. He looked at a usfur. Who was Musa told to go to? Musa was told to go to Khadir to take knowledge from him. And then Nabiullah Musa came to Khadir and he said to him, Are you going to... هَلْ أَتَّبِعُكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُعَلِّمَنِي مِمَّا عُلِّمْتَ رُشْدًا Would you teach me? Would you educate me? Musa saying this. وَلِذَلِكَ The scholars, they say, the first person who set the path in traveling to seek knowledge was Nabiullah Musa. He traveled to seek knowledge. And when Nabiullah Musa, and Nabiullah Musa is better than Khadir. And this shows what? جَوَازُ أَخْذِ الْفَاضِلِ عَنِ الْمَفْضُولِ That if you're sometimes greater than somebody, if something he has will benefit you, you take it from them and you humble yourself. You don't become arrogant. Because the truth and the khair is the lost property of the believer. It's like you losing your phone. If somebody lower than you is holding your phone and says, oh, I found your phone. What do you say? I'm not going to take it from you. You say, this is my phone. Thank you for bringing it back. The knowledge and the haqq is like that for the believer. Whoever gives it to you, it's like, oh, it's mine in the first place. Jazakallah for giving it back. It's the lost property of the believer. So Nabiullah Musa and Khadir are together. Khadir says to Nabiullah Musa, he says to him, Nadara ila usfurin, he looked at a bird, a little bird, and the bird took its peak, a peck, and it put it into the ocean. And it, what can a bird take from the ocean? If it puts its peck inside the ocean, what's the amount of water that it can take? Gallons? Liters? Something very small, right? Drops. And then Khadir said to Musa, Ma ilmi, your knowledge, my knowledge, wa ilmuka, and your knowledge, Musa, in comparison to the knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jalla, is like that bird, what it took from the ocean. Allah's knowledge, that ocean, and what it just took from the ocean like that. We know nothing. And that day, they were the two most knowledgeable people on the face of the earth, that day. So they knew the name of Allah Al-Alim. They understood the reality. وَلِذَلِكَ وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ Everyone who's knowledgeable, Allah knows more than them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ When you pray Salatu Istikhara, what do you say in the Salatu Istikhara, in the dua that you make? فَإِنَّكَ تَقْدِرْ وَلَا أَقْدِرْ You are the one who destines. I don't destine anything. وَتَعْلَمُ وَلَا أَعْلَمْ You know, O Allah, whether this affairs is good for me. I don't know. And then look what the person says, وَأَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ You're the one who knows the unseen. Remember, to Allah, there's no such a thing as unseen. But it is to who? Us. Everything to Allah is seen. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what you say in your istikhara. That you are admitting you have no ability. You're also admitting that the knowledge is not in your hands. He's the one who knows everything. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number 10. Knowing Allah's names, subhanahu wa ta'ala, معرفة أسماء الحسنى أسماء الله الحسنى تورث حسن الظن بالله تبارك وتعالى. Knowing Allah's names will inherit in your heart, will bring into your heart good assumptions of Allah Azza wa Jalla. You know, once you know Allah's names, you will start to have good assumptions of Allah. You'll start to think good of your Lord, Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's what you would do. And he would. The evidence for this is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Quraysh, they came and the Prophet was in a cave with who? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When they were running away from Mecca and they were running to where? To Medina, Gharu al-Hira. Ama Gharu al-Thawr. Gharu al-Thawr. Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr said, لو نظر أحدهم أسفل قدميه لرآنا. Oh Messenger of Allah, if one of them just looks under, just goes down slightly and looks under his feet, he can see us. He will see us. And look what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ما ظنك أبو بكر, what do you think بثنين الله ثالثهما, what do you think of two people, Allah is the third one. Allah is what? Allah is with them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do you think of them? What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have of Allah here? Husnul dhan. He believed high of Allah. Why? Because he knows that from the names of Allah is Hafidh. Allah is the one who safeguards. لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Allah says about the believers who are righteous, there are angels Allah send. What do these angels do? They protect them from the front. They protect them from the back. يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. They're protecting them from all of the evil. Allah does this for the believers. Abu Bakr, what do you think of two? Meaning you and me, and Allah is our third. What do you think? How can these people see us? They will never see us. Allah is with us. This comes, that Allah is with us, and the person has this yaqeen. It comes from knowing Allah. Knowing who He is. Knowing His names. Knowing His ability. That moment when everybody else is giving up, you will laugh at them and say, SubhanAllah, Allah, you don't know who Allah is. Are you with me, brothers? Knowing Him at that moment, it will put that, they'll put that husn al-dhan in your heart. Number 11 is, لا يضر مع اسم الله شيء. Nothing will harm you with the name of Allah. Once you say the name of Allah, nothing's gonna harm you. Nothing's gonna harm you. ولذلك the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ما من عبد يقول في صباح كل يوم. No one says every morning, ومساء كل ليلة, and every single night. No one does this and says this. Every morning and every night he says, بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء. No one says, بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء. No one says this. وهو السميع العليم. ثلاث مرات, three times. In the morning, three times. At night, فلا يضره شيء. Nothing's gonna harm you. The messenger said this. Person says, بسم الله, in the name of Allah. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء. وهو السميع العليم. No one says this three times. In the morning and in the night time. So if you say in the morning, the whole day you're protected. لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. At night time, while you're sleeping in your house, Allah will protect you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did you say? بِسْمِ اللَّهِ, in the name of Allah. So the name of Allah is what's protecting you. It's protecting you. Number 12. الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى, the names of Allah, the noble names of Allah. How it affects وَأَثَرُهُ فِي الْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ. Your meat that you're eating becomes halal and haram based on the name of Allah. Becomes what? Halal and haram. This food, it's halal and it's not haram. It's not halal or it's haram just based on what? The name of Allah. That's why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, فَكُلُوا مِمَّا ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ بِآيَاتِهِ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Eat مِمَّا ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ, that which Allah's name has been mentioned on it. in kuntum, if you are bi ayatihi, those who believe in him subhanahu wa ta'ala, his verses. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala rebuked and he scolded a people who what? That eat. They don't eat. They don't eat that which Allah's names has been mentioned in it. Allah says, وَمَا لَكُمْ أَلَّا تَأْكُلُوا مِمَّا ذُكِرَ اسْمُ اللَّهِ. Why is it that you do not eat that which Allah's name has been mentioned into it? Why don't you eat it? So Bismillah made a meat halal, and without it the meat is what? What is it, brothers? That shows you the magnitude and the weight of Allah's name subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three. العلم بأسماء الله الحسنى, the knowledge of knowing Allah's names is أعظم العلوم وأشرفها. It's the greatest knowledge is knowing Allah's names. There's no knowledge greater than that. Nothing at all. What's the best knowledge? The knowledge of the religion. العلوم الشرعية, Islamic knowledge is the best knowledge. It's better than any scientific knowledge, any academic knowledge. And within the knowledge of the Sharia, knowing Allah's names is the best. You rarely come across an ayah in the Quran except that it has the name of Allah in it, directly or indirectly. Every time when you, Wallahu bima ta'amaluna khabir. Khabir is the name of Allah. Basir, Rahman, Rahim. These are names that you're seeing all the time in the ayat of the Quran. Most mentioned. The most mentioned. ولذلك الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية said والقرآن فيه من ذكر اسم الله وصفاته وأفعاله أكثر مما فيه من ذكر الأكل والشرب والنكاح في الجنة والآيات المتضمنة لذكر أسماء الله وصفاته أعظم قدرا من آيات المعادي. What is mentioned more in the Quran, Allah's names or the mentioning of food and drinking and marriage? Why is it that the most mentioned in the Quran is not the most mentioned in your life? Why is it your food, which you go out 9 to 5 to get a job and to make money, has become the most important thing for you to mention every day and to talk about it? And your marital issues. Ya ikhwa, these have become the most mentioned thing in your day-to-day life. This is not something good. Allah says about the disbelievers, what did he say? وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَأْكُلُونَ وَيَتَمَتَّعُونَ كَمَا تَأْكُلُوا الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًا لَهُمْ. Eating and drinking and marriage is something that all religions share. And it's not the most mentioned in the Quran. The most mentioned thing in the Quran is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's names. So Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah says, in the Quran, the mention of Allah's names, the mention of his characteristics, the mention of his verbs, أَكْثَرُ مِمَّا فِيهِ مِنْ ذِكْرِ الْأَكْلِ وَالشُّرْبِ وَالنِّكَاحِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Then even the mentioning of what? The resurrection. The mentioning of the Jannah and the hereafter. This is more than it. فَأَعْظَمُ آيَةٍ فِي الْقُرْآنِ آيَةُ الْكُرْسِي. What is the most mentioned? What's the greatest ayah in the Quran? Huh? Allah's name has been mentioned in Ayatul Kursi 23 times. Ayatul Kursi, brothers. Whether it be a pronoun or whether it be a what? Ism, which is alam, which is zahir. Ism, which is zahir. Okay, first thing that was mentioned was what? And the last which was mentioned, what? Name and name. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hay. Huwa is him, referring to Allah. ولذلك, one of the reasons why this ayah is the greatest ayah in the Quran is because of the mention of Allah's names. I made a whole lecture on it. It's on my channel. Tafsir and the benefits and the facts in Ayatul Kursi. It's on my channel. In great details I spoke about it. You see, brothers. The Prophet ﷺ, what did he say to the companion? The Prophet said to the companion sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَلَا أُعَلِّمُكَ, shall I not teach you أَعْظَمُ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, the greatest ayah in the Quran, shall I not teach you it? The companion said, بَلَا, بَلَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, of course, O Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, سُورَةُ الْفَاتِحَةِ. وَلِذَلِكَ, the scholars, what did they call it? أُمُّ الْقُرْآنِ, the mother of the Quran. Hey, what's the first thing that's mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha? Yeah? What is the first thing that's mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha? Huh? If we take Bismillah as an ayah in it, how many names are mentioned in there? How many names I mentioned? Three names. Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. What is the most beloved name to Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala? What's the most beloved name to Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala? To name a child. And Abdullah and what? So this shows you how much it means to Allah, Tabarak wa Ta'ala. How much it means to Him. Number 14. The barakah. Barakatul asma'il husna fil ma'isha. In your life today, the name of Allah has a barakah in it for you. It has barakah in it. For example, tabaraka ismu rabbika dhil jalal wal ikram. What does Allah say? Tabaraka ay ta'azama. Great barakah is in what? Tabaraka ismu rabbika, the name of your Lord. In it is what? The barakah. ولذلك, that's why we're told, إِذَا دَخَلَ الرَّجُلُ بَيْتَهُ. If a person enters his house, فَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ عِنْدَ دُخُولِي. When he enters his house, he remembers Allah. He mentions Allah's name. وَعِنْدَ طَعَامِهِ. And when he eats his food, قَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ. The shaytan, they say to one another, لَا مَبِيتَ لَكُمْ وَلَا عَشَى. Today there's no sleeping here, because when he came into the house, he made a dua, that's one. And when you ate the food, or you were eating the food, you said Bismillah. Both times you said Bismillah. Now he says there's no food as well. Think about this, brothers. If your shaytan is getting food and you're letting him stay in your house, are you with me, brothers? Because when you come into the house, you're not saying Bismillah. So he's got a place to stay. And he's also getting food to eat, because you're not saying Bismillah when you eat the food. You're talking on your phone. Yeah. When he gets stronger and he becomes powerful, who's he going to use it against? The energy he accumulates, who's he going to use it against? And then you come running to the Shaykh and you say, Shaykh, I can't pray, I can't fast, I can't do anything. You become a person who shaytan has control over. Why? Because you have chosen not to do that which was simple. So the barakah is that. This is what happens. Number 15. The barakah of Allah's names. In saying Allah's names, the barakah in it doesn't only just stick to you. The barakah actually moves to your children. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, alayhi salatu wa sallam, لو أن أحدكم إذا أراد أن يأتي أهله. If a man wants to have intimacy with his wife, he should say what? Bismillah, in the name of Allah. What happens? He says, Bismillah, Allahumma jannibna ash-shaytana wa jannib ash-shaytana ma razaqtana. Oh Allah, in the name of Allah, divert shaytan from us, me and my wife. Wa jannib ash-shaytana, and divert shaytan from our offspring. Look what the Prophet said. فَإِنَّهُ إِن قُدِّرَ بَيْنَهُمَا وَلَدٌ. If that night from the intimacy that they had, Allah brings a child out of it, لَمْ يَضُرَّهُ شَيْطَانٌ أَبَدًا. Shaytan will never harm this child. They will not come into contact with shaytan. What was the beginning that you said? In the name of Allah. Bismillah, that's it. Just by saying Bismillah, that relationship that took place that night, the child that comes from it, until he dies, Allah will protect him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many parents don't say this? And this is what the scholars mention, is that parents, the rights that your children have on you, the rights that they have on you, it's before they are coming into existence. Some people just think that the rights of the children are once they come into this world. There are rights that they have on you, the children, before they even come into the equation, such as choosing a wife that's righteous. If you pick up any woman from anywhere and you make this child, this his mother, you have forsaken his rights. And then once you marry the righteous wife, that night when you have relationship, you need to mention this dua. This is the right that the child has on you. So the scholars, they break the rights of the children into how many? Rights prior to the child's existence and before he comes into the picture. Rights when he's in this world. People just, that's when they see it. Not even when, they don't even see that. They see when he's 18, 19, when it's too late now. Are you with me, brothers? And then the child has rights on you once he passes away. He has rights on you. Scholars, they mention that, rahimahumullahu. Last but not least is asma'ullahi a'azam. The names of Allah in it is cure. In the names of Allah is cure. By using the name of Allah, there's cure in it. ولذلك حديث أبي سعيد الخدري أن جبريل أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. جبريل came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال يسر يا محمد أشتكيت. You have complained. قال نعم. He said yes. He said بسم الله أرقيك. Jibreel said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم بسم الله in the name of Allah أرقيك. I do رقية to you. من كل شيء يؤذيك. From everything that harms you. ومن كل نفس أو عين حاسد. From every evil eye that wants to plot against you. الله يشفيك. May Allah cure you. بسم الله أرقيك. The بسم الله that he said, he repeated it again. So بسم الله started with in the name of Allah, and it finished with what? In the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That person, when he reads that dua, or he makes that, what happens? The evil eye, the harm that has been put him through, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure that individual from it. So these are 16. And there are much more. If you go to the Butun al-Kutub wal-Mujalladat, if you open volumes of books, you'll find 100% more than this. But now I want you to all understand the importance of learning Allah's names. And understanding it and living by it. Anything which I might have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. Any questions? Huh? Disputed, like in the strongest is that it is, inshallah ta'ala. Well, there's khilaf. Some of the names of Allah is, it's disputed. Like inshallah ta'ala, inshallah it is. Allah's names are tawqifiyah. Tawqifiyah means we can't just name Allah a name because it's a good name. The names of Allah are taken from textual evidences. So the scholars, they base some of the names on whether that hadith is authentic or not. If the hadith turns out to be weak and it's not authentic to them, then there's no, this name cannot be established anywhere else. So then there is no evidence for this name, so they say it's weak. So it's based upon the authentication of a hadith. Does it make sense? وَلِذَلِكَ Allah has characteristics that are not His names. Are you with me? The characteristics of Allah is larger than His names. Every name has a characteristic in it, but not every characteristic is a name. Are you with me? Not every single characteristic of Allah is a name. We don't make a name out of it. BarakAllahu. Huh? I just said, brother asked right now. It was a question he asked. It's a disputed whether the hadith is authentic or not. Whether the hadith is authentic or not is the diskhilaf. Those who authenticate the hadith, they believe that Rashid is the name of Allah. And those who don't, they don't believe it is. So it revolves around the authentication of that particular hadith. Now. Stop there, inshallah ta'ala. BarakAllahu feekum wa jazakum Allah khairan.